Simon & Schuster Audio presents Christmas in Peachtree Bluff, a novel by Kristy Woodson Harvey. Read by Shannon McManus, Janet Metzger, Rebekkah Ross, Candace Thaxton, and Erin Ruth Walker.
Ansley, a Southern Lady. The day before Thanksgiving. For magazines and travel guides, globe-trotting Instagrammers and hotel reviewers, Peachtree Bluff, Georgia was a beach destination best enjoyed during the heat of summer. But as I leaned on the counter at my waterfront design shop, looking out over the Intracoastal, I realized that fall in Peachtree might be our best-kept secret. Yes, summer was great. The sun glinted on the water, the wild horses roamed the islands, and the wind blew more softly through the trees than anywhere else in the world. But fall and winter, when the weather was slightly cooler and the streets less crowded, were glorious. And if you asked a local, nothing beat Christmas in Peachtree Bluff. I perched on the gray and white Parisian bistro stool behind the counter, stack of receipts in hand, to review the sales from the day before. It was the day before Thanksgiving, but already the trees flanking the picture window were trimmed, the Christmas music was playing, and my store, Sloan Emerson, was overflowing with the goodies that I hoped would be mostly gone after this weekend. Between online sales and foot traffic from locals, the store made one quarter of its profits in the weeks between Black Friday and Christmas, so it was paramount that everything be just right. That included my middle daughter Sloane's collection of miniature paintings for sale, arranged on a round antique mahogany table in the center of the shop. Reindeer, the Star of Bethlehem, a shining menorah, and my personal favorite, the Grinch. The quiet and calm, with everything in its place, made this the best way to start the day. It was a time when a woman could do some thinking. Of course, coffee helped. Coffee was key. And, as of yet, no coffee. It gave me a pang for Kyle, the previous owner of Peachtree Perk, not only because I missed his piping hot and always-on-time lattes, which I did, but also because I missed my daughter Emerson and my granddaughter Carter, who went with him to California 3 years earlier. The idea that they were somewhere in the air over Montana right now, on their way from L.A. to Peachtree Bluff, made my stomach turn. I liked it better when my children were on the ground. But the idea that they were on their way here to see me was almost too thrilling to bear. I went through my mental checklist. I had ingredients for Emerson's green juice, Baby Carter's organic milk, Kyle's favorite double-dip chocolate-covered peanuts from the candy shop on the corner, and IPAs from our local Blackbeard Brewing. I couldn't wait for them to get here. As the door to the store opened, the familiar tinkle of the bell rang out happily. "Every time a bell rings, an angel gets her wings," I exclaimed. This morning, like so many mornings, it was my friend, Hippie Hal, who walked through the door. I could see his grin across the store, even underneath his beard, which he let grow in more fully for winter. It was a chilly morning, so he had layered two of his signature white Oxford shirts he always wore with jeans, and a piece of rope as a belt. "I got your latte," he said somewhat grimly as he held it out to me. "Oh, no," I said, standing up and walking around to the front of the counter. "Again?" He nodded. Kyle's cousin Keith had taken over Peachtree Perk when Kyle moved with Emerson to L.A. for her to take a once-in-a-lifetime acting role. When Keith had discontinued Kyle's famous coffee delivery service, we had been aghast. But finally, after years of complaining, he had decided to resume delivery.
What did Keith bring you?
Hippie Hal asked. Nothing, I said gleefully as I took the cup from his hand and smiled. He rolled his eyes, so blue amidst the darkly tanned, deeply lined skin of his face. The bell tinkled again, and Leah, my design assistant, well, really more like my right-hand woman, walked through the door, her wavy red hair flowing over her shoulders. This is convenient, she said. I got a flat white today. Now I don't have to run all over town looking for you. Leah handed Hal his usual coffee order and crossed her arms. Y'all, I get it. We like Keith. Keith is nice, and we're happy he's here. But this is ridiculous. We have to tell him that he gets our orders wrong. I knew she was right. This was lunacy, and we couldn't let it continue.
I'll tell him, Hal said. It should come from a man.
I snapped my fingers. Or we let Kyle tell him when he gets here. Things are better when they come from family.
Leah shook her head.
Things are so much worse when they come from family. I considered that. Maybe she was right. I couldn't be sure. I hadn't had any caffeine yet, after all. The bell tinkled a third time, and in walked Jack, the love of my life, and now, after decades of being apart, my husband. I still got a thrill just seeing him walk through the door, so polished and handsome, but also the right amount of rugged. His salt-and-pepper hair was thick and full, and he had the kindest smile I'd ever seen. Our tiny dog, Biscuit, ran to me, and I leaned down to rub her white, furry head. Jack kissed me quickly. Then he turned and said,
Miss Leah, you are the proud winner of a cinnamon spice latte.
Yes, she said. The day can begin. We're 3 for 4 now, I said happily. Leah rolled her eyes. Ansley, your tolerance is too high. It has only been a couple weeks. I think we need to be more patient and— Oh, Jack interjected. Keith told me to let y'all know that he baked loaves of fresh pumpkin bread for all his regulars. They're waiting, and you can grab one at your convenience. Hal, Leah, and I groaned in unison.
What?
Jack asked.
Do y'all have something against pumpkin bread?
No, Hal said. It's just that every time we decide to do something about the messed up coffee orders, he does something so nice that we can't.
He did just donate that money for the new bleachers at the high school, too, Leah said. Traitor, I said, pointing at her. You're the maddest of all, and you cave the fastest. A tinkle of the bell, and Kimmy, our resident produce woman, walked in, basket of squash, sweet potatoes, and lettuces in hand. She had been growing out her short, spiky hair, and it was almost to her chin now, and pink. She'd gone back to her natural black for a while last year, and it just felt wrong.
Oh, good, you're here, she said, handing the basket and a cup to Jack. These are all your Thanksgiving veggies, and your plain black coffee.
Yuck.
Jack raised his cup to us like he had just won the lottery.
Good things come to those who wait.
Or complain, Kimmy countered.
Why can't one of you tell him that he's screwing up the whole town's orders?
Kimmy was by far the snarkiest of the group and cared very little about anyone's feelings.
Why don't you tell him, I countered, if you're so bothered?
Because he's my second biggest client. Do you know how many strawberries that man buys? I can't be on his bad side.
She looked around the circle expectantly. Jack put his arm around her shoulder.
No takers here, Kim. Let's go down to Page and Stage. Claudia certainly has a mean streak.
He paused and perked back up.
And hey, maybe she has your coffee, too. From your mouth to God's ears, she said.
He turned back to me. 5 days, Anne's. 5 days.
I know, love. I said back. 5 days from today, Jack and I would leave for 3 weeks for a trip we had wanted to take since we were teenagers.
I never would have imagined that, decades later, after I had been a widow for 16 years, he would come back into my life and we would fall in love, get married, and finally be able to cruise the Australian coast like we had dreamed, and explore Indonesia as a bonus. I had some qualms about coming home only a few days before Christmas. But my daughter Sloane, who was living next door to Jack and me with her sons and husband, would be the one hosting this year anyway. She was in the big house.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.